Every town and county in America has some claim to fame. Whether it be a popular restaurant, a sightseeing destination, or a person, there is something that makes every town unique and sets them apart. And for my home county of Scotland County, Missouri, that something is a lady that stood above the rest. Not many towns, as small as Memphis or Gorn, have a person of significant recognition. They might have a D-list celebrity that was born in their town, or a senator that once called the area home. But their local golden child often isn't known beyond a few square miles of their town or county. Scotland County has a few notable features that an outsider might not know about it from seeing the city at just a glance. We were the birthplace of the infamous murderer, Tom Horn, and the Pheasant Aircraft Company, and we currently have several monuments dedicated to the town's involvement in the Civil War and the Downing House Museum. Though the building has been a staple of beauty and history in the county since 1858 and has been a museum since 1978, I have never stepped foot inside of it. I've lived in the town of Memphis for almost 2 decades. I was born and raised here. A special room in the museum is dedicated to a lady that has helped me to form my own understanding of my county and its history. So, I decided to dig a little deeper. Ella Ewing, a woman known and beloved by only a few, is the pride and joy of the people of Scotland County. Unless you're from this state and you've made a Missouri notebook in elementary school, you may have never heard the name of Ella Ewing. But around these parts, she's a fixture of memory. So what do you guys know about Ella Ewing?
Ella Ewing, she is very well known here in Memphis. And everybody reads about her and they tell stories about her.
So Ella Ewing was born and raised around the Scotland County area, down around Gorn.
That she used to do the circus.
And she used to tour with the circus.
She was in the circus.
My husband's mother saw her at school one day and she went home and she says, "Oh, Papa, there's the tallest woman I've ever seen."
I know about Ella Ewing that she was the tallest woman in the world and she stayed at the Downing House by our house and we have a book about her.
I can remember my husband and I taking our 3 daughters down to Harmony Grove Baptist Church. Ella Ewing's actually buried in the cemetery down there. And we took them down there, and our oldest girls were, I'm going to say, about 8 years old, and our youngest was 2. We took them down there to see this because they've heard about her in school and just in the community. And we take them down there, and we had each of them lay down. You know, the first one would lay down, and the next one would lay down, put their feet on the next one's head. And all 3 of them laying down, they still weren't as tall as what Ella Ewing would have been.
So it's a special thing to read about.
Though I had my own loose understanding of Ella Ewing and the life she lived, I knew that I didn't have all the facts, and the best place to find that was in the Downing House Museum in Memphis. The Downing House Museum has a special room dedicated to Ella Ewing. The room is full of artifacts, photographs, and much more. While at the museum, I found an interesting book by Barbara Chastain entitled Ella Ewing, Missouri Giantess, and it was a perfect place to start digging. In special collections at Truman State University, I found the book, and the stories told between its covers enlightened me to a whole new side of Ella and her adventures. Ella Kate Ewing was born and raised in Rainbow, Missouri, a town which is now only a part of distant memory. She was the pride and joy and only child of her parents, Benjamin and Eliza Ewing, and was born at a healthy 7.5 pounds on March 9th, 1872. Ella lived a relatively normal life for the first few years. Her family owned a farm, and she spent her days doing chores, going to church, and learning in a one-room schoolhouse. She quickly excelled in school, and it didn't take her long to advance in her reader's books. When she turned 7, however, life began to change in big ways. Due to a condition that affected her endocrine, or pituitary gland, her extremities, like her arms, legs, fingers, and toes, began to grow to outstanding lengths. By age 12, she was taller than her mother, who stood at 5'6", and by the age of 18, she had grown to be 8 feet 4 inches tall. She was too large for typical beds, chairs, clothing, and doorways, so everything had to be specially made for Ella. Though she stood out from the crowd, she was accepted as a normal girl in Scotland County. It wasn't until this sweet, quiet, gentle giant was 13 that she would feel like she was different. On July 4th, 1885, she was asked to read the Declaration of Independence at the old Sutter Farm near Wyoconda, Missouri. Only a few words into her monologue, the crowd began to point and laugh, noticing her abnormal size. Ella left the stage crying, embarrassed by her looks. And for a while, she avoided leaving home in Scotland County at all. That was until 1890. A man by the name of Louis Epstein made Ella an offer that she could not refuse. For just 30 days of exhibiting in his museum in Chicago, Epstein would pay Ella $1,000. For a family that had trouble keeping their farm year after year, this was an offer that they couldn't pass up. The family hopped on the Santa Fe Railroad in Gorin, a neighboring town of Rainbow, and headed towards Chicago. Not many people would have ridden on a train in 1890, especially someone from a small Missouri town. The cost would have been too much. At 3 cents for every mile, a ticket could become quite pricey, especially if you were traveling as a family. But because Ella was so extraordinary, she would get the chance to do many amazing things, and riding on a train was just the beginning of it. After a nerve-wracking month, Ella returned home, and her family realized that this could change their lives for the better. If people were going to stare at Ella for being different, they figured that they might as well make a dime off of it. The tours in his Chicago museum wouldn't be the only place that the Ewings would encounter Louis Epstein. In fact, he was the man who truly changed Ella's exhibition life forever. In 1893, Epstein asked the Ewings if he could sponsor them at a sideshow at the World's Columbian Exposition. The expo would take place from May to October, and it was going to be a spectacle like the Midwest had never seen before. The opening day alone would blow people away. Full of speeches from people like President Grover Cleveland, the day would open up in a celebration of the world and of the United States. Buildings like the Electrical Building amazed the crowds and featured electric lights, something that had just emerged in the world, and a moving walkway. For people like Ella, a small-town farm girl, to see something as amazing as this must have been such a great opportunity. The fair would receive over 45,000 people a day in its first month, and by the end of its first 3 months, it would have more visitors than the state of Missouri had people. To have witnessed something like this would have been an amazing pleasure, and knowing that a girl from my own county got to do so is invigorating. In 1897, Ella would get the chance to do something just as exciting as the World's Fair. She would get to travel with the circus. More specifically, the Barnum and Bailey Circus. Though her friends and family were morally against the circus, as they had only heard the crude side of the story, like tales of gambling and drinking, $125 a week, and a promise from Bailey himself that the people of his circus were of high morals, persuaded the Ewings into letting Ella go. She would make over $3,000 during her 6 months with the circus, which was enough to keep her and her family in a good financial place for years to come. After getting 8,000 headshots printed, Ella and her cousin, Teent Blackwell, would set off on their circus adventure. At the time, the Barnum and Bailey Circus was the most extravagant one around. When they would perform, they would have beautiful ladies, talented acrobats, and wild animals galore. Ella got to visit most of the country, including New York City, Washington, D.C., St. Louis, and many other stops along the way. Everywhere they went, they would bring a parade and posters to hype up their crowd. Ella really enjoyed her time with the circus, but when they went to Europe the next season, she had to leave her friends behind. Going to Europe on a boat wouldn't be feasible for someone of Ella's size, so she decided to stay home and await her next opportunity. And that next adventure would lead her to the Buffalo Bill Wild West Show. Ella and her mother left Gorin on March 4th, 1898, exactly 100 years to the day of me being born. and headed out on her worst exhibition circuit yet. Unlike the Barnum and Bailey Circus, the Buffalo Bill Wild West Show was full of the heinous acts that her family had heard so much about. They were described as crude, raw, rude, and undisciplined. After just 3 months, Ella broke her contract and returned home, never really exhibitioning much again. She had made enough money to build herself a house where she could entertain her friends and tell stories of her life that lived high above the expectations of everyone else. Reading about Ella's life in the 19th century and the few years that would follow, I was amazed to learn about the things that her life intersected with, like the 1904 World's Fair, the true hype of circuses and freak shows, the creation of the cross-continental railroad, the invention of electricities, phones, cars, and so much more. As I reflect on my own life as a girl in rural Missouri, I can't think of anything exciting that's happening to me. I haven't been a part of any major events in history. Sure, I've got to witness the boom of the internet and the cell phone, but I will never get the chance to experience a life quite as grand as Ella's. The 19th century as a whole had some amazing things happening in the blink of an eye. Wars, countries, art, literature, music, industry, inventions, everything was changing. And Ella got a first-hand glance at it all. Ella isn't just the tall woman from Scotland County who toured with the circus. She's so much more than that. She's a representation to me and the people of Scotland County that there is a much bigger world out there, which is changing every day. And sometimes it takes people like Ella Ewing to see it, from a bird's eye view no less, for us to truly appreciate it and reflect on it.